I thought I was gonna die. My whole world as I knew it just crumbled. I thought, I can't ever do that. I cannot do that. Every night I would sit up in bed thinking, how am I going to do this? It made me feel guilty. I thought, doesn't he know that I don't know anything? That I've just been faking?
With bombs dropping and war surrounding, Yuta Dorotea Giza was born in the middle of World War II, surrounded by death and destruction on a daily basis. It was not uncommon for neighborhoods to be completely destroyed.
When I was about six, I'd play in all the ruins, and I pretended like it was my home because some of the walls were still up, and there were steps going to nowhere.
Although the sounds of bombs continually rung in her ears, she always felt an odd sense of security because of her parents' love and protection. Even when she wasn't home with her parents, she still felt safe.
And I always knew that when I came home, my parents were there. And I was never alone. I was always nurtured by them.
If the war hadn't been traumatic enough for a young child, her parents packed her up and moved everything to America when she was 12.
Oh my God, it was very, very frightening. What a culture shock when I came to America and I saw all the cars that were different colors and these huge buildings.
After several moves, the family settled in Van Nuys, California, still feeling like the foreign, unwelcomed outsiders. Her appearance didn't help the situation either. Her tall, awkward German figure stood out from the normal American look, which made her insecurities start to form.
And there was no category for girls like me that were tall and skinny and had a funny name.
In spite her efforts to fit in through middle and high school, Yuta always felt like the awkward German girl that would never truly be as good as an American.
I was kind of my own little world. I didn't have many friends. I did not know the language. That was humiliating.
In her senior year of high school, she was faced with the difficult decision of what comes next. But her insecurities made it difficult for her to find a clear path, especially when she felt like she didn't even have a place in the world.
When I graduated, you married at 19, or you become a secretary, which was out of the question for me because I couldn't type. I flunked it. So then, maybe a nurse, but I couldn't do that. I couldn't see anybody hurt or sick because I would end up thinking I had the same sickness.
Yuta was unconfident and disoriented looking towards her future. One of the graduation requirements of her senior year was to prepare a project that explored a career that the student was interested in. This project was one of the most pivotal experiences in Yuta's professional career and life as a whole.
One day I was walking by a beauty school, it's called Marinello's. And I kind of peeked in there and I saw these little leaflets that they had. And I thought, oh, well, let me look at it. Took a whole bunch home. I thought, well, I could make a report from this.
It turned out not only to be a school report, as Yuta got her first job as a hairdresser after completing high school and beauty school at Marinello's. She felt fulfilled. Yet, she never saw life taking her anywhere else.
I worked in your normal little beauty shops where the ladies would come in every 15 minutes for their standings.
Not only did Yuta quickly become accepted into the professional working world, she also officially became a United States citizen. And to go along with her newfound citizenship, Yuta decided to officially change her name from Yuta Dorothea Giza to Dorothy McQuown.
I could change my name. Dorothea was my grandmother's name, but in American, it was like Dorothy. That's how Dorothy became. I was so thrilled, Dorothy Giza. And then somebody called me Dottie, and I thought, oh my God, this is the ultimate. I'm really happening here with a name like Dottie. Little did I know that I would miss Yuta. And that little girl will never be around again.
With her new American name and her new job, Dottie finally could breathe a sigh of relief. She finally was confident in who she was and in her career. But that was only until she received a surprising phone call from her high school friend Donna, who was a casting director for television.
Donna called me and she wanted me to work on this show tomorrow at Too Close for Comfort.
Immediately, Dottie's fears and insecurities came into view again. Too Close for Comfort was a top 10 TV show on ABC that needed an assistant hairdresser during season 2. Donna knew this was a perfect opportunity to get Dottie working on the show.
And it was a very popular show with Ted Knight and Nancy Dussault. It was a sitcom. And I said, Donna, I can't do that. I can't do that.
This was way out of Dottie's comfort zone, and she knew her parents would not approve.
My parents kept me very simple, that I should just go to work, do my job. And I think now, when I think back, they just kind of did that to protect me.
She didn't have to chase fame in order to make her parents proud. They were already proud of her. That's why her parents never encouraged Dottie to dream big, because they didn't want her to get hurt.
Well, they wouldn't want me to go there. That's for other people. That's not you. You have to stay, do what you're, just work in a little salon. People might hurt you in the other big studios.
These thoughts from her parents ran through her mind, but Donna didn't take no for an answer.
So she nagged me until I finally said, okay. So I went, and Donna was thrilled to death because Donna always prided herself that she knew everything, that she knew the best. And she thought I was the best. And she had more faith in me than I did. And she saw stuff in me that I never did.
Dottie felt encouraged by Donna's faith in her. But her parents' thoughts raced through her mind as she went into the studio on her first day.
Well, I was shaking. I had never been on a studio soundstage before. And I was like in awe of everything.
Dottie was in a whole new world. She was no longer in a small salon. She was now in a major film studio.
They would constantly yell, hair, hair, and I didn't know that was kind of a normal thing because they would be looking through a lens and, sometimes they'd move and their hair would be in front of the shoulder when it should be in the back. And I didn't know that I had to look for all those things, But it didn't take me long to kind of learn. And they were really happy with me. So when the next season started, they asked me to take it over.
Although Dottie worked on Too Close for Comfort for another 4 seasons as the head hairdresser, she felt unqualified for her position.
I really never felt that I was good enough.
Whether or not she believed in herself, she did good work. Word was spreading throughout the industry that she was really good, and in the beginning of 1987, she was approached by Fox Television to work on a brand new show.
Somebody called me and said, oh, would you be interested in doing a little show about a family from Chicago. By this time, I'd gotten a little bit more comfortable, and how bad could it be? Little, So anyway, it turned out to be married with children. Well, boy, did I have a lot on my plate.
Since this was a new show, Dottie had to design personalized hairstyles for each character to match their personality. This was something she had never done before that would test her creative skills. All her fears and doubts came creeping into her mind.
How do you do that? I didn't know if there were any books on that, but I don't think so. Every night I would sit up in bed thinking, how am I going to do this?
One of the hardest to create a look for was lead actress Katie Sagal, who was cast to play the iconic role of Peg Bundy.
It was hard. I was trying to do her hair kind of to go with her wardrobe, because she was kind of, you know, how she walked and everything. So finally I said, Katie, why don't we do a wig, you know? And she said, she says, I've been thinking about that too.
Dottie created the wig, which turned out to be one of the most iconic hairdos of all time, because it represented the character perfectly. She was really getting noticed by her peers from what kind of work she could do.
She has a great ability to analyze a face and to see what style looks best on them, but that doesn't always work for TV. You have to study a script and you have to see what that character should be. So if you're a homeless person, you have to create that hairdo. If you're a person from 1950s, you have to know that style. So her breadth of knowledge really has to cover thousands of years, and she's able to do that. She can do things with wigs that a normal person could never do. And that just shows her great ability to create something so special, so unique to that character, so defining to that character. And she continues to do that naturally every day that she's creating for television. And that's an amazing gift.
Katie Sagal's character, Peg Bundy, was being noticed all over the country.
It became really, I mean, every Halloween you would see nothing but the wigs and her clothes. I was just so grateful. It turned out to be one of the most successful shows ever.
It was because of the wig that Dottie made that was the reason for all of this attention.
In addition to that, she is so famous because she created the iconic look that we all know as Peg Bundy.
So again, here we are in the makeup room. Now, Dottie does, she's responsible for Katie's hair, for Peggy Bundy's hair.
And we all know, you know, the Smithsonian takes on these special cultural American images like Dorothy's shoes from The Wizard of Oz and Miss Child's kitchen. Well, Dottie McQuown's hairdo for Peg Bundy should be there, and I think it will be one day.
She's so good. She created one of the most iconic hairdos in all of television on Married with Children on Peg Bundy. She should have won every Emmy that there is to win for that. But back in those days, they never gave Fox any awards.
I was very proud of myself at that time, considering that I really never felt that I was good enough, or I always thought, when are they going to find out that I don't know what I'm doing, that I'm just pretending that I knew what I was doing.
Dottie worked on Married with Children for 11 seasons, but this was just the start of her career. Her work on that show led to many other shows that she worked on. And although Dottie was successful, she still did not feel as if she deserved all of this credit. Her parents' thoughts of big studios still echoed in her mind, that she wasn't qualified for this kind of work. But she was greatly respected throughout the industry, and her peers knew that she was good.
When I left Deal or No Deal, one of the young hairdressers came up to me and said, Dottie, I wish I would have 2 more years with you to learn everything you know. And I thought, doesn't he know that I don't know anything, that I've just been faking?
Of course, Dottie's doubts come to mind, but she finally is struck with confidence. After years of doubts and insecurities, Dottie kept her head held high, starting her last job where she currently works today at Fox 11 News in Los Angeles.
All those years, back to the old days when she worked with the big, big stars, and now she works with us, she is like a genius in 2 seconds, can do anything. This is a person who really is one of the best of the best of the best, and we're very lucky to have her with us all the time, one of the best in the business.
From a normal hairdresser to her journey through Hollywood, Dottie made it to the top without thinking she could ever do it. Her parents kept fears in her mind, but it only made her work harder and to overcome adversity on her own.
If I could talk to my parents now, and if I had something to say to them, I would say just thank you. Thank you for your love and your protection. And I think you still made me what I am. Thank you, Mom and Dad.
Through it all, Dottie has become a role model for us all. She only thought she faked it. The reality is she made it and left her story in the pages of Hollywood history.
Just follow your dreams. It's an amazing journey. It's like up and down, because it was always one way. It wouldn't be any fun. There's a lot of challenges, and then when it works, boy, you can pat yourself on the back. If anybody ever says to you, you can't, you just show them that you can. Look at me. And guess what? I still don't know how to type. And you know what? Now they throw texting at me. No texting. No typing. Hate it. Thank you. Actually, my name was Jutta Dorothea.